Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present Thieves of State, Why Corruption Threatens Global Security, by Sarah Chayes, narrated by the author.
Chapter 1. If I see somebody planting an IED. Afghanistan, 2009. The man before me, young, passionate, brilliant, difficult, was transfigured with a barely contained rage. "I called the chief of police," he plunged on with his story. "And you know what he said? He asked me, 'Well, did he die of it?' Think about that. You call that law?" Nurullah and I and perhaps a half dozen others were sitting behind the stout mud brick walls of the compound that served as our workshop, tucked away on one of the unpaved back streets of Kandahar, Afghanistan. I can't remember now what we were doing, eating a breakfast of spiced tea and our own almond butter on flat bread, or else packaging bars of the handcrafted soap we lovingly manufactured there. This would have been early 2009. Nurullah was telling me what had happened to his brother. We were always doing this, sharing stories as we worked. It took hours each day just to process it all. Improvised bombs would rattle our windows as they detonated, pounding the air like thunderclaps, or like great objects falling in the next room. I used the formal Arabic word for explosion, infijar. The guys had trouble pronouncing it. The Pashto was so much more intuitive, patau. We'd climb up to the roof to look for the smoke, or else not, for fear of presenting a target. We'd try to guess the direction of the sound and think of someone to call on that side of town. We'd listen avidly to stories of the Taliban's rule a few dozen miles away in the flat, vine-studded village where Abdullahad's brother tended his land, the makeshift mines the militants buried to keep people indoors at night, the taxes they collected, the telephone tree where they hung the carcasses of cell phones they confiscated from passers-by and broke with rocks. They didn't hang the people there. They hung the people at the former schoolhouse. Just as often, the horror stories were about the Afghan government. An Albany man whose father was blown up in a 2005 explosion during a funeral at a mosque had to pay a bribe to get provincial clerks to fill out the death certificate. Big, gutsy Nargis from the wild country in the north, with her gypsy air, was married to the garbage man, a wizened whitebeard who heeled a little to the right as he trundled his wheelbarrow from house to house on our well-kept dirt street. They, like so many other Kandaharis, lived in the graveyard, in a hovel built over somebody's tomb. Now Nargis was in a panic because the mayor had announced he was bulldozing the squatters out, in line with the 5-year plan. Thousands of them, in the middle of an insurgency. One day, weathered elders from Hijran Karez, a village over the rocky ridge to the east of town, came and knelt on our floor to tell their story. President Hamid Karzai's younger half-brother, Ahmed Wali, had claimed dozens of acres in the watershed of their precious spring as eminent domain, and then proceeded to subdivide it and sell it off like his own private property. Bulldozers, protected by police brandishing AK-47s, and driving U.S.-supplied Ford Rangers, had carved up the land. That was the kind of story Nurullah was telling. His brother Najib owned an auto parts store at bustling Sharpur Gate, the mouth of the narrow road linking their village to the city, an ancient byway that had once led southward through the passes all the way to India. At dusk, it's clogged with a riot of vegetable sellers' handcarts beset by shoppers, Toyota pickup trucks, horse-drawn taxis, and three-wheeled rickshaws clambering around and through the throng like gaudy dung beetles. Nurullah's brother Najib had gone to Chaman, just across the border in Pakistan, where the streets are lined with cargo containers serving as shops, and used motor oil cements the dust to the ground in a glossy tarmac, and every variety of automotive organ or sinew is laid bare, spread out, and strung up for sale. He had made his purchases and set off back to Kandahar. He paid his customs dues, Nurullah emphasized the remarkable point, because that's the law. He paid at every checkpoint on the way back, 50 Afghanis, 100 Afghanis, A dollar or two every time an unkempt, underage police boy in green fatigues slouched out of a sandbag lean-to into the middle of the road, 8 times in the 66 miles when last I counted. And then when he reached the entrance to town, the police there wanted 500 Afghanis. 500! A double arch marks the place where the road that swoops down from Kabul joins the road leading in from Pakistan. The police range from one side to the other like spear fishermen hunting trout in a narrows. He refused, Nurullah continued. He said he'd paid his customs dues. He showed them the receipt. He said he had paid the bribes at every checkpoint all along the way, and he was not paying again. I waited a beat. So what happened? They reached into his window and smacked him. They hit him? I was shocked. Najib might be a sunny guy, but Kandahar tempers are strung on tripwires. For a second, I thought we'd have to go bail him out. What did he do? Nurullah's eyes, beneath his widow's peak, were banked and smoldering. What could he do? He paid the money. But then he pulled over to the side of the road and called me. I told him to stay right there, and I called Police Chief Matialakate to report the officer who was taking the bribes. And Matialah had scoffed at him. Did he die of it? The police buzzards had seen Najib make the call. They had descended on him, snatched the phone out of his hand, and smashed it. You call that law? Now Nurullah was ablaze. They're the police. They should be showing people what the law is. They should be enforcing the law, and they're the ones breaking it. Nurullah was once a police officer himself. He left the force the day his own boss, Kabul Police Chief Zabit Akrem, was assassinated in that blast in the mosque in 2005. Yet so stout was Nurullah's pride in his former profession that he brought his dark green uniform into work and kept it there, hung neatly on a hook in his locker. My sacred oath, he vowed, concluding, if I see someone planting an IED on a road, and then I see a police truck coming, I will turn away. I will not warn them. I caught my breath. So maybe he didn't mean it literally. Maybe Nurullah wouldn't actually connive with the Taliban. Still, if a former police officer like him was even mouthing such thoughts, then others were acting on them. Afghan government corruption was manufacturing Taliban. When that conversation took place, I had been in Afghanistan about 7 years. I had entered Kandahar in December 2001 on the heels of the fleeing Taliban as a reporter for National Public Radio. Before long, I resolved to set aside my journalism career and stay to help Afghans rebuild their shattered but extraordinary society and discover in this crisis, I hoped, an unanticipated opportunity. My focus was on economic reconstruction, not rule of law. Yet within weeks, I was hearing stories of shakedowns by thugs in uniform, the private militia of Kandahar's warlord governor. As early as 2002, Kandaharis were pointing anxiously to the presence of notorious criminals in their new government. Years later, due to my long experience in country, I was asked to serve as an advisor to the U.S. military. By then, I had watched that early chaotic warlordism take hold and solidify. I had listened to hours of my neighbor's anguish about it. And so, given the opportunity, I spent much of my energy trying to persuade international officials to take corruption seriously. I was sure that unless they recognized the danger it presented and addressed it head-on, they would never win the war. That 2009 morning, in other words, was hardly the first time I had considered that kleptocratic governance, acute and systemic public corruption, was fodder for an expanding insurgency. Nurullah's tale was just the most striking demonstration. Corruption, it made plain, was not solely a humanitarian affair, an issue touching on principles or values alone. It was a matter of national security, Afghan national security, and by extension, that of the United States. And if corruption was driving people to violent revolt in Afghanistan, it was probably doing likewise in other places. Acute government corruption may in fact lie at the root of some of the world's most dangerous and disruptive security challenges, among them the spread of violent extremism. That basic fact, elusive to this day, is what this book seeks to demonstrate. Chapter 2. Lord King, how I wish that you were wise. Mirrors for Princes, about 700 to 1516. The prince ought to inspire fear in such a way that, if he does not win love, he at least avoids hatred. This he can always do if he abstains from the property of his citizens and subjects and from their women. Niccolò Machiavelli, The Prince. In the fall of 1513 and into the winter, on a small property lapped by gently rolling Tuscan hills, where December's chill brought mud, not ice, a disgraced former Florentine civil servant named Niccolò Machiavelli wrote some pages of practical advice on how not to lose a principate. His rigorously unromantic approach to the subject has become eponymous. That Machiavelli's everlasting fame should have been connected with cunning, self-interested, autocratic rule is something of an achievement. Mere months before he put pen to paper, he had been arrested and tortured and had barely escaped beheading by the very family of the prince for whom he wrote The Prince. In fact, Machiavelli was an ardent believer in representative government and had spent more than a decade in the service of Florence's short-lived republic. When the Medici family invaded the city at the head of a papal army, toppled the republic, and retook power themselves, Machiavelli was dismissed, suspect for his prior loyalties. Within months, his name showed up on a list in the pocket of a harebrained conspirator against the Medici Restoration, and Machiavelli was clapped in irons and carried off to Le Stinche prison, where interrogators broke his arms by hanging him up by the wrists bound behind his back. He made light of the screams in a sonnet for Cardinal Giovanni de' Medici. Machiavelli survived by fluke. Giovanni was elected pope and, in thanksgiving, set all the felons free. Confined to his rural family estate, Machiavelli apparently decided the one way to return to the intoxicating tumult of his beloved politics was to prove he had forsaken his former ways and was now a reliable supporter of Medici rule. That was part of his objective in writing The Prince. To court Medici approval, he went so far as to challenge the time-worn list of virtues that members of budding rulers' entourages traditionally served up in books of advice addressed to their lords. Piety, for example, fear of God, mercy, and generosity were predictable, if perhaps unappetizing, fare. Machiavelli deliberately played the contrarian. It was acceptable, he wrote, even beneficial, to be mean, not generous, to be harsh, not merciful. Those more bitter qualities, he contended, if properly understood and embodied, could keep realms secure and princes from perdition. But there was one vice that Machiavelli admonished his reader to shun if he cared to prolong his reign: theft of his subjects' possessions. In other words, corruption. Being rapacious and arrogating subjects' goods and women is what, above all else, renders him hateful, he wrote. And widespread hatred of a ruler was conducive to conspiracy, and conspiracy reliably brought down governments. Machiavelli knew the prince was vying with long tradition. The rich and well-known body of advice literature was referred to collectively as Mirrors for Princes. Hundreds had been written and copied and traded across continents by the time Machiavelli wrote his. An anonymous Irish mirror, addressed in verse to a mythical king, was composed around AD 700, and was as poetic and primeval as any of that island's literature. Clerics and courtiers wrote them, even monarchs for their heirs. James VI of Scotland, for example, who would become James I of England when Queen Elizabeth I died childless, penned one for his son Harry. His Basilican Doron endures as one of the signal expositions of divine right monarchy. Lo here, my son, a mirror view in fair, which showeth the shadow of a worthy king. Lo here, a book, a pattern doth you bring, which you should press to follow mare and mare. I first encountered this body of literature decades ago while studying history, medieval Islamic history, in fact, for Muslim scholars and statesmen wrote mirrors for their princes, too. I perused several while considering writing a dissertation on systems of justice, a dissertation I ultimately discarded, and with it my studies. But one day, browsing the shelves of the bookstore at the Institut du Monde Arabe, on a Parisian break from Afghanistan, I happened upon a remembered text, translated from the Persian in one of those voluptuous laid paper softcovers that French publishing houses still put out. A Treatise on Government, it's titled, or Siyasetname, literally, Book of Politics. I bought it and brought it back to Kandahar. Its author, Nizam al-Mulk, organizer of the realm, was one of the greatest, most thoughtful, and foresightful administrators in the Muslim world. Born around 1018 in what's now eastern Iran, he was the son of a provincial tax collector for the Ghaznavid Empire, whose capital was the city of Ghazni, about 3 hours' drive up the Kabul road from our workshop in Kandahar, where I was reading Nizam al-Mulk's text. His world flourished at the confluence of three powerful human currents: a millennial Persian-speaking tradition of letters and administration, a crystallizing Muslim orthodoxy expressed in Arabic and nominally represented by the caliph in Baghdad, and an increasingly separate secular power wielded by Turkic sultans and their semi-nomadic troops. Nizam al-Mulk was chief minister to two of those sultans in turn. Coming from the Persian tradition himself, he wrote Siyasetname not just to help his second master keep his principate, but to show him how to consolidate, organize, and expand it. Nizam al-Mulk contributed to that effort by overhauling and streamlining a complex land grant system for paying military commanders, and by expanding, in order to ensure a supply of competent civil servants, an educational innovation: residential institutions of higher learning, otherwise known as colleges, or in Arabic, madrasas. When, around 1090, Sultan Malik Shah asked his peers, elders, and men of science to reflect upon the constitution of his government, the aging Nizam al-Mulk produced a manual that, while full of colorful anecdotes, is at least as practical as the prince. Its chapter headings catalog the administrative functions required in a sophisticated empire: of financial inspectors and their means of subsistence, of envoys sent out from court for important matters, the necessity of maintaining supplies of forage at way stations, the necessity of a racially integrated army, of civil servants. Alerted as I was by then by the frustrations of my Afghan neighbors, I found myself increasingly spellbound by the book's admonitions against various forms of corruption. Only what is just should be exacted from God's creatures, and it should be requested with gentleness and consideration. If an official assesses a farmer more than is due to the authorities, the sum he unjustly raised should be demanded of him and returned to the farmer, and if the official has any property, it should be confiscated as an example to other agents, so they refrain from tyrannical acts. Now, there was an anti-corruption measure that would make an impact. If the police officer who had shaken down Nurullah's brother had lost his house over it, others might think twice. Stories of land grabs, like the ones taking place in Kandahar, come up again and again in the treatise. It is reported that the powerful 8th-century governor of Basra, Umar ibn Hamza, attended Caliph Wasiq's audience on the day the caliph was meting out justice for those complaining of arbitrary conduct. A man rose and accused Umar in these terms: "Umar ibn Hamza forcibly commandeered a property that belongs to me." According to the legend, Umar, thus shamed in public, renounced the property on the spot. Half a dozen pages are devoted to the tale of an aged widow who gleaned a bare subsistence from a parcel of land that the governor expropriated, and the legendary Persian king Anushirvan's investigation and redress of the grievance. Another monarch of Persian fable, Bahram Gur, comes to suspect his most powerful minister of corrupt practices. To learn more, Bahram Gur decides to question detainees in the main jail. "I had," said one, "a beautiful and pleasant garden. Minister Rastrevish possessed a domain nearby. One day he entered my garden and was enchanted by its beauty and voiced his desire to buy it. I refused to sell and he had me arrested." The man had been in prison for 4 years. Other stories follow in a similar vein. This Persian fable's narrative device would sound perfectly contemporary to residents of present-day Kandahar, where arbitrary detention to extort a fat payment, or looked at differently, official kidnapping, is a frequent event. Say the man's a Talib, and few would question his arrest. Nothing preoccupied Nizam al-Mulk so much as justice. "The salaries and emoluments accorded to judges," he wrote, "assure their independence and keep them from unfairness. This point is extremely important and extremely sensitive, for judges dispose of the lives and fortunes of Muslims." One king is described descending from his throne to kneel down in public audience if a subject has a complaint against him, and warning the judge of judges to rule without favoritism on pain of death. By including such tales in so many variations, Nizam al-Mulk was hammering home a point that a government's ability to administer justice, and especially to hold its highest officials to account, was indispensable to its very survival. One story about Omar ibn al-Khattab, an early caliph whose name became synonymous with justice in Islamic literature, has him promise on his deathbed that he will return to visit his heir in a dream within 3 days of passing. But it takes 12 full years for the new caliph to dream of his father. When the young man complains about the delay, Omar explains he was too busy to come earlier. "A bridge in the region of Baghdad fell into disrepair because local officials neglected its maintenance," Omar tells his son in the dream. "A sheep's hoof got caught in a hole in the bridge and broke. From the day of my death till today, I've been discharging my responsibility for that accident." Outside Kandahar, beyond the arch city gates in the direction of Pakistan, a long bridge straddles the shallow, winding bed of the Tarnak River. That bridge, rebuilt and paved with international development funds in 2003, was always coming apart. Inching past the latest hole in its surface, colleagues and I would peer down at the stony river through a tangle of steel reinforcing rods denuded by the missing concrete. Often the bridge would be closed altogether, and we would join the rest of the traffic, gaudily caparisoned cargo trucks with their skirts of jingling chains, taxis and minivans, police trucks, white Toyota Corollas with their bouquets of children peering out the back window, and jump the banks of the road, angle downward through the talcum powder dust till we reached the river floor and navigate a route across the shallowest stretches of water. That bridge was a constant affliction to Kandaharis. People would trade figures on how much money had been allotted for the repair. They knew how the scam worked. The well-connected outfit that had won the contract would transfer it to a subcontractor, pocketing a percentage. That subcontractor would hand the deal off to a sub-subcontractor, also minus a cut, till the company actually doing the work received only a fraction of the initial contract and threw something together with shoddy materials and underpaid workers. Meanwhile, cocky young employees of the companies up the line would thrust around town in slick SUVs worth years of an ordinary farmer's harvest. "We know all this money is coming in," a man from the orchards north of town once told me. "We just don't know which hole it's spilling out through." That bridge kept springing holes, and the foreigners kept paying more money for more repairs. And no one, so far as we knew, was called to account. Prefiguring a modern judicial notion known as command responsibility, Nizam al-Mulk emphasized rulers' ultimate accountability for the doings of their subordinates. He repeatedly warned Sultan Malik Shah that his reckoning would come. "May the king, God render his reign eternal, understand that when on judgment day he is examined about all the creatures that were placed in his power, should he try to point out another to answer in his place, that person's testimony will not be heard." This strong emphasis on the accountability of those who wield power for the actions of their underlings, because the good and the bad that they do reflects on the prince and his government, is equally explicit in today's Kandahar. As Afghans, beginning around 2005, found the international presence in their country increasingly offensive, it was not because of their purported age-old hatred of foreigners, nor did puritanical horror at the presence of unbelievers in their land enter our conversations, or outrage about Afghan sovereignty trod underfoot. My neighbors pointed to the abusive behavior of the Afghan government. Given the U.S. role in ushering its officials to power and financing and protecting them, Afghans held the international community, and the United States in particular, responsible. My neighbors wanted the international community to be stricter with Afghan government officials, not more respectful. "You brought our donkeys back," one man put it in 2009. "You brought these dogs back here. You should bring them to heel." "The government is your face," Nurullah told me a year later. "If it's pretty or ugly, it's your face." Rereading Nizam al-Mulk's nearly 1,000-year-old political treatise, I was struck by how specific and detailed its relevance was. The point for me was not so much that corruption has always existed, as many who aim to downplay the problem helpfully point out. Remarkable to me was the clarity with which a great statesman of the Islamic Middle Ages linked the problems of corruption and injustice and perceived the danger they posed to organized government. And I found myself wondering as I finished his book, did other writers of manuals of advice for monarchs see it the same way? Did they too pinpoint corruption as a critical threat to the stability and security of the realm? Mirrors for princes stud the literature of the Western Middle Ages. In the Carolingian period, for example, several were addressed to Emperor Charlemagne's turbulent offspring. Around the year 831, one Jonas, bishop in the graceful Loire Valley town of Orléans, addressed of the royal institution to the emperor's grandson, Pepin I. High among the recommended virtues that fill the book's pages is, once again, justice. "He who is judge of judges must introduce into his audience the cause of the poor and diligently inform himself, so it does not come about that those whom he has delegated to take care of the people in his stead allow the poor to be victims of oppression." As in the Islamic text, accountability for iniquitous officials lies with the king. When dishonest judges are placed over the people of God, the fault lies with him who appointed them. Across the religious divide, Jonas depicted a god who will be just as terrible as the later Nizam al-Mulk's in calling the king to answer for the ministry that he has received. Jonas was even more explicit about the likelihood that injustice perpetrated by governing officials would lead to rebellion or rupture of the peace between peoples. The title of his sixth chapter spells it out. The equity of judgment is the consolidation of royalty, and injustice its ruin. During a later chapter in the epic European struggle between church and state, one that rocked England to its foundations in the 12th century, another churchman, John of Salisbury, wrote a mirror for King Henry II. The book, called Polycraticus, an invented word, is full of keenly observed and bitingly rendered anecdotes about various categories of official misbehavior. John displayed an equal talent for theorizing. He suggested a broad category, and a loaded one, within which the forms of misconduct he portrayed might fall. Tyranny. In Kandahar today, the same word is used to describe the same type of deeds, an Arabic loanword into the local Pashto. Zilm, tyranny or oppression. I heard that word every day. A prince, John of Salisbury explained, differs from a tyrant in that a prince obeys the law and rules his people by its dictates, placing himself at their service, and administers rewards and burdens within the republic under the guidance of law. And law, John construed, is the instrument of equity, which compares all things rationally and seeks to apply like rules of right and wrong to like cases. As for a tyrant, John hazarded a revolutionary doctrine, that by the authority of the divine book, it is lawful and glorious to slay public tyrants, so long as the killer is not bound to the tyrant by an oath of fealty. It's not clear that a later English text, The Mirror of King Edward III, written around 1330 by a country vicar named William of Pagula, ever made it into the hands of the prince to whom it was addressed. Less taken with offering instruction than with leveling criticism, the book would have tried the king's patience. Fueling William's rage was King Edward's resuscitation of an ancient royal right to requisition goods and services from his subjects in order to help fund his wars. And men of your court, not men, precursors of the Antichrist, seize many goods by violence from the owners of those goods, namely, they seize bread, beer, fowls, cocks, beans, oats, and many other things for which practically nothing is paid. Woven as he was into the daily lives of his parishioners, William was painfully acquainted with the spiraling consequences of such shakedowns. A poor man comes to the market with one ox, which he plans to sell to discharge a debt. He has to pay one mark on a certain day or lose his own land. His ox is seized by your ministers and nothing is paid to him, because of which he loses his land and incurs perjury, excommunication, and a reputation as a dishonest person. Like other mirror writers, William of Pagula held the king responsible for his men's conduct and warned of the national security consequences should the corruption continue. And for you, Lord King, unless you ordain otherwise, the loss of your kingdom must be feared. In 1332, William sat down and wrote another whole book, whose language echoes the spluttering frustration of the first. Four chapters in, right there on the page, he dissolves into what can only be described as a howl. Oh woe! Oh shame! Oh disgrace! Oh infamy! Oh affliction! Oh ambition! Oh struggle! Oh compassion! Oh outcry! Oh damnation! Oh sadness! Oh error! Oh falsehood! Oh fraud! Oh theft! Oh plunder! Oh infidelity! Oh ingratitude! Oh instability! O labor, O tears, O lamentation, O martyrdom, O lying, O perjury, O danger, O fear, O scandal to you, king. The man, I thought when I read this, is screaming. And his screams sounded like those of Afghans I knew. How can we work with this government? One elder from Shawalikot District challenged me in May 2009. The government doesn't hear our voices. The government doesn't do anything. It's just there to fill its own pockets. Oppressors, tyrants, liars, bribe takers. If the government administration in this country isn't reformed, it doesn't matter how many soldiers the Americans bring. The situation will never improve. Afghans were screaming. And like 14th century William of Pagula, they were going unheard. The Renaissance saw a spate of mirror writing. One author whose fame almost rivals that of his contemporary Machiavelli was the Dutch humanist Desiderius Erasmus. Just 3 years after The Prince was completed, Erasmus dedicated his own Education of a Christian Prince to the future enormously powerful Holy Roman Emperor Charles V. Though Erasmus supported monarchy and would oppose the heretical wildfire of religious reform that shortly exploded across Europe, his conception of the people, bound in an organic relationship to their prince, is strewn with the radical seeds of modern democratic arguments. Nature created all men free, he opened one section, which admonishes against reducing free citizens into slaves. In another, he argued not only that laws should not favor the mighty, but that their application should actively help redress power imbalances. The whole purpose of the law should be to protect everyone, rich or poor, noble or humble, serf or free man, public official or private citizen. But it should incline more toward helping the weaker elements, because the position of humble men exposes them more easily to danger. The law's indulgence should compensate for the privileges denied them by their station in life. Erasmus warned of acute economic inequality, seeing in it a potent danger to the health of the empire, a concern that led him to the brink of advocating a redistributive income tax. Within this context, he defined corruption. Corrupt princes pick out from the mass of their subjects a wicked few who use cunningly chosen pretexts and constantly changing excuses to drain off both the strength and the wealth of the people and then convert it to their own account. It is as if the prince were the enemy of his people, not the father, and the prince's best minister the man who most effectively thwarts the well-being of the people. And people so thwarted, as Erasmus's pragmatic Italian contemporary warned, would bear violent grudges. He who is threatened and sees himself constrained by necessity, either to act or to suffer, becomes a most dangerous man for the prince, wrote Machiavelli, not in The Prince, but in reflections on the writings of the ancient Roman author Livy. Those injuries of possession and honor are matters that harm men more than any other offense, and against which the prince ought to guard himself, for he can never despoil one so much that he does not leave a mind obstinate to vengeance. Thus did these two great but very different 16th century political thinkers come together on one point, not just the moral evil, but the danger to the realm and to the stability of the region around it of acute public corruption. Indeed, nearly all the mirror writers, Christian and Muslim alike, divided by the centuries and by different systems of government, seem to have shared a consensus that eludes many of today's policymakers, that acute, abusive government corruption prompts extreme responses and thus represents a mortal threat to security. There's just a slight problem with this whole body of literature, reiterating down the ages thoughtful, often detailed and colorfully phrased warnings against corrupt practices. Other than threats of divine punishment in the afterlife, these manuals fail to suggest any systematic means of redress against corrupt governance. What if their royal readers were to ignore their advice? What would happen then? Disaster, collapse of the state through tyrannicide or revolt, hangs behind their words like a dark thunderhead. For what other options remain for the aggrieved people? To whom should they appeal? Chapter 3. Hearing the People's Complaints. Kandahar to Kabul, 2001 to 2009. In Afghanistan, my neighbors, barred as they were from U.S. bases that grew more fortified with every passing year, with taller walls, more loops of barbed wire, increasingly complex screening procedures, were on a similarly fruitless search for appeal. Often they came to vent their frustrations to me, the only American within reach. My presence in their midst had not resulted from any pre-existing logic. I had no family roots or professional background in Afghanistan. I first came to consider the place half a continent away, in the legendary but painfully dilapidated blue and white Mediterranean port city of Algiers. It was 1998. Algeria was in flames. A decade earlier, massive popular protests, much like the 2011 Arab Spring that erupted in neighboring Tunisia, had forced the autocratic and self-serving government to open the political process and allow multi-party elections. A religious movement with a burning sense of purpose, grassroots organization due to its access to neighborhood mosques, and a reputation for honesty conferred by the presumption of a devout population, was the chief beneficiary of the pent-up protest vote. During Algeria's first-ever free parliamentary elections in 1991, this Islamic Salvation Front trounced the ruling party in the initial round of voting. Then the army stepped in, canceled the election, pushed the prime minister from office, and seized direct rule. What resulted was a protracted civil war, whose death toll is still uncertain, but is believed to top 100,000. Massacres were visited on sleeping villages at night. Hundreds were slaughtered, knife to throat, in hours-long orgies of killing. Infants' brains were dashed out against walls. And through it all, a horrifying doubt persisted about the role of the government itself. Algerians I met suspected then, and more believe today, that the security forces facilitated some of the butchery to scare the population away from the Islamist movements back into the fold of the single party. Neither the army nor the militants seemed concerned with giving the people a stake in their future. As the violence reached its paroxysm in 1997 and 1998, I covered Algeria for National Public Radio. Visas to the police state were hard to obtain and were delivered arbitrarily and on very short notice. Trips to the countryside, where survivors stood stupefied amid the wreckage of their ordeal, were orchestrated by Algerian gendarmes. Most of the local journalists we were permitted to meet were ferociously anti-Islamist. My idiomatic Arabic helped break the ice, but I had the nagging sensation I was missing the crux. Still, I learned something about political Islam during those years. I was brought to consider, for example, the garb that its adepts affected. Square-cut tunics or monotonous headscarves tied under women's chins, modeled on styles from the Gulf or Afghanistan, where many Algerian men had traveled to work as laborers or to fight. These clothes contrasted with the equally modest but quite different traditional local dress, which could vary from village to village by a hem of lace or the hang of the drapery, communicating geographical origins or personal taste. "It's a uniform," a local historian explained to me. "This clothing has nothing to do with piety. This is about advertising adherence. And like any uniform, military or school or Boy Scouts, it removes a person's individuality. Its wearer becomes a faceless member of a mass movement, whether he lives in Algeria or Egypt or Saudi Arabia. Even without the violence, I realized, this burgeoning political Islam was not just an expression of devotion. It was a militant, doctrinaire response to something. One day, one of the Algerian journalists, whose almost impossible working conditions were the topic of my next radio report, mentioned Afghanistan. "Here, the story is over," he commented matter-of-factly. We were chatting in the sun on the cement stoop of the press center where he and his threatened colleagues had their offices, under the watchful eyes of their police protection. "The rise of militant political Islam," he clarified. "That story has moved on to Afghanistan." I nodded silently, not entirely sure what he meant. Less than 4 years later, on December 11, 2001, I was clinging to the back seat of a yellow taxi, whose color and license plates trumpeted its Pakistani origin, in the company of a burly but terrified driver, an equally terrified interpreter, and a euphoric teenager from the Afghan border town of Spinboldak, proud bearer of a Kalashnikov and a couple of pistols, whose militia commander had lent him to me as a bodyguard. I had my mic out and tape rolling, trying to capture the teenager's comments above the remonstrances of the taxi as it negotiated the river of rocks and dust that passed for a road. We shimmied down the last spiny crest above the Afghan city of Kandahar. 2 days earlier, the battened-down, earth-colored city had been the stronghold of America's new enemy, the Taliban. Now, anti-Taliban militia in turbans and flowing tunics, rocket launchers lashed to the struts of their pickup trucks, were charging through the streets on patrol. And already, through their relief, nervous residents were voicing fears that the warlords, a haunting memory from the early 1990s, would return to replace the now-hated Taliban. Tribal elders in the nearby province of Farah appealed for UN peacekeepers to come and disarm the people, not just Taliban remnants, but U.S. armed government-affiliated militias, too. I was covering the fall of the Taliban for an American public, including my NPR editors, that was still too badly rattled by the earth tremor of the 9/11 terrorist attacks to think clearly about the events, their significance, or the mix of underlying motivations that might have led men to perpetrate them. Within another month, I had made the abrupt decision to drop my journalism career and stay behind in Afghanistan to try to do something. To me, this staggering crisis seemed to provide a once-in-a-generation chance to reimagine the world, to try to contribute to one where the people of two different but deeply interconnected, culturally rich and diverse civilizations might examine and take account of each other's perspectives. It was time to stop talking and roll up my sleeves. For my first 2.5 years in Kandahar, I worked for President Hamid Karzai's older brother, a Baltimore businessman named Qayyum. I was hired to launch the activities of an NGO of unclear mission that he and his wife had registered in permissive Delaware. Neither we nor my older sister, who gallantly leaped into the endeavor, knew much about what we were doing. We blithely combined a sister school program with a radio station, a women's discussion group on the drafting of a new Afghan constitution, with rebuilding a village that had been flattened in the U.S. bombing, and a socioeconomic study on the potential impact of repairs to a canal system in a neighboring province. While perhaps dysfunctional, that unorthodox diversity did provide a broad-spectrum exposure to the realities of Afghanistan's chaotic transition. It took me a while to realize I had better acquire some notions of accounting, for I was never asked for a budget or reckoning to submit to the Delaware tax authorities. I dodged a suggestion of Qayyum's that we hit up the U.S. Agency for International Development for funding to help his brothers develop a housing project outside Kandahar. That place, built on public land that the Karzais obtained for the equivalent of a symbolic dollar an acre, grew to be a fantastically lucrative, city-sized gated community whereby they and their partners profited from the violence that came to reign in Kandahar by selling coveted building plots for a fortune in cash. For a while, Qaeda insisted that our NGO should organize armed village watch groups and serve as the intermediary between these militias and the Interior Ministry. That did not seem an appropriate activity for a U.S. 501c3, and I balked. At first, I believed Qaeda's description of himself as constituting a loyal opposition to his younger brother, the president. His analysis of events was mesmerizingly brilliant and has shaped, to this day, my understanding of his country. Not for years would I begin systematically comparing his seductively incisive words with his deeds. Welded to his brother's interests, he behaved in ways that contradicted his...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.